We can start with the next talk. I'm very happy that the second time we have representatives of the Charlie 25 team here, which is a local club from DARC local club from Ehring, and they have designed a transceiver around the Red Pitaya, which is a really fantastic board. I have four of them. But I don't have the most recent one yet, and I think the Charlie 25 transceiver is such an interesting device. I will build one myself, and I will not for sure purchase any more Superhead transceiver in my life.
Bravo.
That's a promise, isn't it? So please welcome on the stage. As representatives of the team, we have four guys all together here, and they will all help together for the questions and answers after the talk. Here on the team, please welcome Edwin Richter on the microphone, first of all, and Markus Gundner. Edwin is Delta Charlie 9 Oscar Echo, and Markus Gundner is Delta Golf 8 Mike Golf. Please.
Okay, good morning, and thank you for joining us. I'm Edwin, DC9OE, and it's now the second time that we talk about our little project here. The last time was in 2017, and the project has evolved a little bit. I think people would say it has mushroomed over time, and it has become bigger and bigger and bigger all the time, and I'm not sure it's always under control, but we are making progress. And for those of you who are interested, we have a booth. I forgot the number. What was the number?
It's 472 in A1.
Yeah, so we have a booth on the DARC stand, and you can see all the details of what I talk about right now. So we are a project team which is now working since about 4 years together. Actually, we have started already in 2014. We started first with some homebrew kind of technology. It was already software-defined stuff, but we did our own using analog devices, chips, and later we stumbled across Red Pitaya. This was in 2015. So the team is consisting of Markus, who's here. Another Markus, which is currently not here. I think he is holding a presentation somewhere else. Currently at the moment, and Erwin Rau, who's sitting over there. So the team is available for questions and answers if you have any. What we have done basically and what we evolved to is some hardware and software around the Red Pitaya. When we started in 2015, Red Pitaya was at its very early stage. Pavel Demin, who's doing all the firmware software on the Red Pitaya, had just started in 2015 to develop the software. He started with a receiver program first. We tested the receiver stuff together, Pavel and myself, and we found some bugs, so Pavel improved the software, and then of course the wish came up to have a transceiver, and Pavel developed transceiver software, and the rest is history. And for those of you who have used Red Pitaya over the last couple of years, you probably have noticed that there has been a continuous improvement and a lot of change in the software that Pavel has done. The best recent change that I've seen was in cleaning the TX signal. Until end of last year, the transmission signal was not very clean from Red Pitaya, and Pavel has done a lot of work to clean the system much more, and it has become much cleaner, both on the 14-bit version and on the 16-bit version of Red Pitaya. So Red Pitaya also has renamed their boards to STEMlab in the meantime. In the beginning it was a bit confusing, now I think we are all used to it. So we have basically STEMlab 10, which is not so interesting for us here. We have STEMlab 14 and we have STEMlab 16. When we did the first tests in 2015 to 2017, and for those of you who have been here in 2017, you might remember that we have tried to get a Red Pitaya modified with all the analog components taken out. So Red Pitaya had modified a STEMlab board for us taken out all the analog components, which is the operational amplifiers, which are in the front end of STEMlab 14. And I will show on the next page what improvement we got. And since that time, we discussed with Red Pitaya and we asked them to provide us with modified STEMlabs on a standard basis so that other people could benefit from it as well. Red Pitaya was a little bit hesitant in the beginning. They didn't like to modify the STEMlab 14 because it was too much effort and it was complicated in the whole process, and the end result would have been a board which simply would be too costly. None of us would have bought the modified STEMlab 14 with the modified front end. But what happened then? We convinced them, and I think we were not the only ones. A lot of people asked them to modify the STEMlab. So together with other people, we convinced them to take all the analog stuff out of STEMlab and just put the transformers in, which are necessary because of the input structure of the analog digital converter and also the DAC. And to our positive surprise, they not only modified the front end, but they came up with a 16-bit version instead of a 14-bit version. So now we have a 16-bit version of STEMlab, and it really performs much, much better than the older version. First of all, the sensitivity has gone up dramatically. You have now a sensitivity of minus 122 dBm, an MDS of minus 122 at 500 Hz bandwidth. The old Red Pitaya, the number is wrong here, was not 107. It was somewhere between 113 and 115 when you measured it. And the clock has changed, of course. The frequency change is not the most important piece here. What is important is the phase noise of the new clock is much, much better than the phase noise of the old clock. The 165 dBc here is not correct. It's the data sheet of the oscillator, which is on the board. But in real life, as you know, it's difficult to get the data sheet data out of an oscillator. So the practical oscillator on the board is somewhere better than 150 dBc. Red Pitaya has measured it with 155 dBc at 10 kilohertz distance from the carrier, of course. What is also important for us is there are no anti-aliasing filters anymore in either the receiver front end or in the transmission front end. And of course, I have tested the new STEMlab now on 2 meter because this was the most interesting piece. I had done it already with the old STEMlab 14 with the modified front end. It was working already then. But what is interesting now is that it is also quite sensitive on 2 meter, and you reach minus 120 dBm MDS on 2 meter when you use it on 2 meter. And of course, as you are free now to use various Nyquist zones, you can also use it probably on 4 meter and other bands as you wish. What is not working very well is 70 centimeters. Also, the data sheet of the AD converter says that it works up to 500 megahertz. On the practical STEMlab now, it doesn't work to 500 megahertz, and I think the limitation is with the transformers. The transformers which are in here work pretty well for 2 meter, but they don't work for 70 centimeters. And when I find some time, I will probably take one board, take the transformers out, and put some high frequency capable transformers in and see if it works on 70 centimeters as well. But it depends a little bit on time. So. Yeah, this the slide is not correct. This is my old picture from 2017, where we tried to compare the modified STEMlab with the original STEMlab, and we gained around 10 dB in intermodulation at that time. And this was the start of the discussion with Red Pitaya. Okay, so much about Red Pitaya and all the changes you have seen there. Now, over the last couple of years, we have spent a lot of effort to develop the necessary hardware around STEMlab to be able to build a complete transceiver, and that's why I say the project has mushroomed a little bit and has become bigger and bigger and bigger, because we always came up with new ideas of features that we would like to have, and at the end all those features need to be put into hardware some way and also put into software. So Markus was pretty busy as well, and he will talk about that later on. So we were busy developing hardware, and one small example is the codec board. Here you might want to ask, why the hell do you develop a codec board? Because there's plenty available from the Chinese for $20, and a lot of people are using them, and also successfully using them. We were not satisfied with the cheap Chinese board for a couple of reasons. One was it tends to be pretty noisy, at least in my transceiver prototype that I built. I had lots of noises in my headphone, and I didn't like it. And the reason, in my view, is that they don't differentiate enough between the analog ground and the digital ground of the codec, which is on there. This was one reason. The other reason was that the Red Pitaya or the STEMLab board is not really happy with a heavy bus load on I2C. And as you probably remember, all our boards are controlled via I2C. So the naked STEMLab is not happy to drive more than one or two I2C devices. And that's why we have put an I2C buffer on the codec board as well. And of course, you want to have a reasonable amplifier for your sound in there, so we put a 2x7 watts amplifier in there. And another problem that was with a cheap Chinese board, it creates a lot of noise from the quantization from the digital analog converter, and we have put a low pass filter on our codec to avoid this. So even our little codec here has become a four-layer board, because we differentiate now the analog ground to the digital ground and all those wonderful things, and it does not create any additional noises anymore. Of course, you have to be careful when you put it into an actual transceiver to make sure that you take care of the difference between digital and analog ground, otherwise your noise comes back again. So much about the codec board. Then the main board. You might have seen our boards evolving over time. The first board was built in 2015. Of course, it was only a four-band board. Later on, some versions of those boards could be found in the Hamlab from Red Pitaya. So Red Pitaya was using them, or they were using our original design, but they did their own layout. So you found those in there. And as I said before, our project has mushroomed a little bit because everybody has its own view on what a transceiver should do. And we have tried to really put every functionality and use every functionality of the STEMLab board and put it into one board here. And this is what we have done. First of all, before I talk about the transmitter and the receiver, we have put a DC-DC converter on there to make sure we have 5 volts in there for the Red Pitaya and for all other pieces that you want to use in your transceiver. We have put a very detailed power control system in there, so if you have overvoltage or undervoltage or too much current, the board makes sure that nothing is destroyed. There's also an output on the board which comes after all those safety measures. So any component that you put into your transceiver is saved by the onboard features that we have put in here. So overcurrent protection, false polarity protection, overvoltage protection, and so on. And of course, for those of you who want to use the board with an accumulator, the board takes care that you don't destroy the accumulator. If the power goes below 10.5 volts, the board is switched off. So this is taken care of. So on the transceiver side, we have 20 watts of output from 160 to 6 meter. I've tested something on 600 meter as well. You get some output there. You can use it. You can play around with it. It's not designed for it, but it would work. It's now a push-pull design. The original one was a single transistor design. So the harmonics have improved pretty much. And we have a very robust kind of transistor in here, which survives almost everything. I've tried to overload the board, so there's an overload protection for the transistor in there. And different to what other designs do, we don't measure the SVR here. We don't care about it, we only measure the current of the transistor. So as long as the current is below 5.4 amps, we don't care what kind of antenna or wire or whatever you put on the outside. If you overload the board above 5.4 amps, it will simply switch off. And to give you an idea what it means, I've tested the board and I have tried to overload it, so all the boards that we sell, the boards right now, all the boards that we sell have been tested for overloading, and it usually switches off at about 30 watts on 6 meter and about 40 watts on 80 meter. So you cannot destroy it. So even if you use it with full power and you use the wrong filter bank, it will simply switch off the transistor, and that's it. Okay, so on the TX side it works pretty well and pretty reliable. On the receiver side we have two channels and with low pass filters, and by the way, one important thing here is as the 16-bit stem lab has no anti-aliasing filters in there, it's very important to have those filters on the board here. So we have a 60 megahertz low pass on the receiver side, and we also have 55 megahertz low pass on the transmission side, so the board is taking care of the anti-aliasing part. What I forgot to say is the STEMLab 16 has much lower output power than the original STEMLab, so we have an extra driver on the board here to take care of that. Okay, and of course we have attenuators and preamplifiers on the board, so it's very sensitive, about minus 139 dBm if you like. And yeah, that's basically it. All the stuff on the board is I2C controlled from the software that Markus has written. This is also true for predistortion. We have a predistortion attenuator on here. And I think Markus will explain when he goes into the software. Then we have developed a filter board. You might have seen we have tested a lot of filter board architectures, and what we came up with finally was the filter board architecture that you see over there. I think this architecture was originally coming from the microwave environment. It was not used so much for high frequency. In the beginning we had some problems to calculate the filter, so I simulated it with ELSI. In the meantime, the other Markus, which is not here yet, has written a software so that we can calculate the filters. The filter works very well. You just see the 160 meter curve here, and what is very interesting is the far off attenuation. It's about 80 dB or so. You won't find any other filter here on the fair in any other device that has such a far off attenuation. So it works pretty well, and you can put two of those filters on our mainboard. So, and from all those components, we built basically two types of hardware. One is the Radiolab, which is similar to what Red Pitaya called the HemLab. So you just need the mainboard, you need a STEMLab, and you need the codec board, and you are done. Of course, you need to do a little bit of cabling. And all the STEMLab inputs and outputs are available on the front panel, so if you want to use it as a network analyzer, for example, you can still use it as a network analyzer, or if you want to use it as a spectrum analyzer, you can still do it. So this works pretty well. For those who are afraid of complexity, you can do it very simple, like I've done it there. This is basically what you need to make this working transceiver. So it doesn't need to be complicated. It looks a bit ugly, but it would work this way. And of course, now we have all the hardware available that is required to make a very nice transceiver. So you see the transceiver over there. And for those of you who are interested, we have all the hardware on the booth, and you can come over and look at it. Okay, then I think we are ready with the hardware, and I hand over to Markus for the software part.
Okay. So thanks, Edwin. As mentioned before, I'm Markus Grundner, DG8MG. I'm the, let's say, main software developer. The most time I'm working on PowerSDR Charlie 25 edition, as we call it. It is based on the original Flex Radio PowerSDR, which was put on open source a few years ago, and we're also the colleagues of the Open HPSDR project have continued on and have put in a lot of stuff for the Hermes board, as you might know, the HPSDR board and the Anan systems that are already on the market. And what we are doing here is to put some additional features on it to adopting the PowerSDR version to all the hardware that Edwin has described before. And what I'd like to show you today are some features that I have worked with the colleagues in the last few years and which I think are should be mentioned here because they have some special functionalities that are currently not available on the other transceivers that are already there. What you see here is the general setup and the graphical environment of the so-called diversity functionality. Many of you might notice in general, the general algorithms were not developed by us or by me. They are put in the so-called WSDP library from Warren Pratt from the OpenHPSDR project, so the credits go to him and his team. But what I have put on top of these algorithms is the so-called auto-diversity functionality. In the previous versions, you have to regulate the gain and the phase of the two antenna signals that you get in via the red pitaya, in our case, from RX1 and RX2. And a few years ago, I already had the idea to put in an automatic, because a lot of ham guys know that the diversity functionality is there, but they don't know how to handle it. And so I thought I'll do some tests on it with Erwin. We had also built up such a diversity functionality in real hardware with analog stuff, and it worked pretty well at our club station where there is a big central heating for the whole building, which is doing a lot of noise on 40, 80, and 160 meters. We tested the analog version, and we were pretty happy how to eliminate the noise. And then we sort of how to bring this automatics into our PowerSDR edition. And this is what I did. So I'll show you in the next slide how it is working. Just waiting to start it up here. No.
I think it doesn't start. It says a video, but I think it doesn't
work. There will be a video in it. So. No. No, it doesn't like us. No, there's the QuickTime is not available. So I'll try to explain it to you manually. So as I said before, the GUI was already there from the colleagues of the Open HPSDR project. What I have added here in the GUI is the so-called auto button. So usually you click on the auto button. What it will do, it will first set up the gains of both receivers to the equal level, and after that it will spin around here from 0 degree phase angle up to 360 degree of phase angle, and calculating in the background the optimized point here of gain and phase, and set it up to the optimized point. And what happens then in the spectrum, and also, of course, in your speakers, is that the signals that are due to all the noise are hidden in the noise level, are coming up out of the noise level because the noise signal ratio is improved, and you can hear and receive stations that you could not receive without these diversity functionalities. If you are not happy with the setting that the auto diversity functionality has found for you, you can still use your mouse and put the dot here, which shows you the current phase angle and gain manually to a maybe more optimized point if you like. So this should be all on the diversity topic. Going on with the predistortion functionality, what I have implemented here for our hardware, as Edwin had mentioned before, we have put in an additional step attenuator into our new board here to regulate the level that is put back to the RX2, to the second receiver input of the Red Pitaya. And what this algorithm here is doing, he is looking for the optimized signal level here of the backported signal to more linearize the TX signal. The idea comes from a time where the first Anand boards didn't have such a step attenuator, and it was pretty difficult for the OEMs to put these levels on a correct level so that the pre-distortion functionality could work in general. And here I also did an optimization and an automatism in our software so that the OEM does not need to care about all the settings and the numbers he has to put into the setup to make the pre-distortion work with his special power amplifier he has, because it always depends on the hardware you have connected behind your transceiver. For the main board that Eswin had mentioned before, the measurement head is already integrated for the 20 watts power amplifier on our board. If you want to use it in combination with an external power amplifier to have more power output, you need to put in an external measurement head which can work on these higher levels of output power, and the rest is then done by our software here. There are special IOs on the main board to connect the external measurement head, and it will regulate all this stuff for you automatically. So that's so much on that. What I want to now describe in a few words, you see here the so-called front panel of our Charlie 25 transceiver. And as you might see here on the picture, on all these red buttons here and also on the knobs on the left side, there are no special names of any functionalities like band switching or band numbers or filter bandwidth numbers or things like that. Why is this the case? We have decided to give them general names and numbers. Why did we do that? Because our front panel can be programmed individually. Every OEM can have his own setup for his transceiver and put any functionality on the buttons or knobs he likes. So this is also done by some extensions I have put into PowerSDR, but this is also based on the OpenHPSDR MIDI interface that was there before. So I've optimized it and extended for our hardware. And now we have a fully universal front panel board that everybody can configure as he like. So here you see the transceiver in general on the right, the top side. On the left lower side, you see the front panel, which is where the front is taken away. You see there is a PCB behind it with all the knobs on it, with the control logic in it. There is an Arduino Micro on it, which then is connected via USB to the integrated or to the external PC. and it communicates on the software level via the MIDI interface, which is already there in PowerREST EDR of the OpenHPSDR team. And on the right side here, you see all the knobs that have been programmed individually by me. And they are programmable on two levels. So I implemented a way on the Arduino Micro and also on PowerSDR that you can push the buttons a short time below a half of a second, and it is triggering the first functionality of one button. And if you press the same button for longer than 500 milliseconds, then it is switching to a, I call it second level, where another functionality is then triggered, which is based on the same hardware knob. So we can put a lot of functions here on it, and also the knobs on the side will be programmable on two levels. I'm still working on this part of the software together with Edwin to finalize the front panel from the development side. So much on that. And then some information about the availability of the components that Edwin has described before. Already available is the StemLab from RapidTire, and also the new version, the 16-bit version that Edwin has described, the transceiver mainboard that he had shown you, the codec board and the RX filter boards, which are optional. And what we are currently working on is the Radiolab housing, the mechanics and all the stuff, also for the Charlie 25 transceiver with the display in it and an integrated PC if you want to have it all in one case. So that should be all from my side. Are there any questions?
Thank you for the very interesting talk. I think it's a very cool idea to use a MIDI protocol.
Yeah.
I know it very well because I'm a musician.
Okay. You know it better than me, I think.
maybe. More from an application side. Yeah. Would it be possible to use a conventional MIDI controller to connect it to this equipment?
Yes, it is. I think you are talking about the DJ Pulse, right? I also something got like, one of like Behringer this. And I've already used it, especially the big wheel on it. I've used it as a VFO knob, and it's pretty cool to work with it. Yeah.
By the way, it works cool. The other way around. You can use our front panel as a music instrument.
Yeah.
Yes. That's a cool idea. Yeah.
I have a question regarding the difference of performance between the modified RapidTire that you presented in 2017.
Yeah.
And a new model, which has just been released. I noticed that the difference of dynamic range between the two ADCs, at least according to the analog device specifications, is only 3.7 or 4 dB. So I was wondering, you know, if I own today a modified RapidTire based on...
It depends of what you compare. If you compare the modified RapidTire with the new, the modified StemLab 14 with the new StemLab 14, or you compare the standard StemLab 14 with the new version. The modified version, the difference between the modified version and the new version, of course, is not so big, because you can simply go in the data sheet and you see the difference between one ADC and the other ADC, and that's basically what the difference is. Currently, the StemLab 16 is usable from -2 dBm, which is S9 plus 71 dB, all the way down to -122 dB. That's basically the dynamic range, so roughly 120 dB. If you look at the S-meter and you say, what is the dynamic range of our S-meter, then the S-meter is absolutely linear in dB steps from -5 dBm down to about -105 dBm. So if I use my Rohde & Schwarz generator and I step in 1 dB steps, our S meter will go in 1 dB steps all the way down over 100 dB range. So this is basically what the current version can do. But of course, if you have a modified, and the other thing which you should not forget is the phase noise of the new clock is much better on the new STEMlab 16. So this is a bigger part of the difference to the STEMlab 14.
Congrats for your very good work. I have a question about the diversity noise cancellation feature that you have. So you calculate the best phase difference between the two antennas, and then you just sum up the two signals.
Yeah.
So this, I think, with this way, you can cancel up to one strong noise source, right?
Pardon? One signal. No, it works interestingly. It works over the, let's say, I have not measured it how wide the frequency band is, but interestingly, it really works, let's say, over one hem band. But as I said before, the basic algorithm is not developed by me. It's developed by Dr. Warren Pratt as part of the Open HPSDR project, and it's part of the WSDP library. This is where the complex mathematics are going on in this library, you know.
Thanks.
Yeah, you're welcome.
So which amount of suppression did you achieve?
Take the microphone, please.
So which amount of suppression did you achieve with that?
What was our best case, Erwin? Do you know it out of the moment?
This is a really good question because it depends on a certain...
Of course.
Thank you very much. The point here is your noise. How looks your noise? Is it a stable noise, what you have, like we had shown here? So the video was not working, otherwise you had seen how the functional is. Or you have a frequency was going up and down. This is much more complicated. Yeah. The point here is in our, what we saw on a very good effect was in our club station. We had S9 plus 10 noise level. Yeah. So with the auto calculation of this system, we bring it down from S9 plus 10 to about S3, S4. And this is tremendous, S3, S4. You still saw some of these signals small down. You see it also here in the picture, you have seen this. So we could not really bring all of that out, but you bring it on a level that you hear all the stations. And this is the improvement of that. I mean, this is nothing new. All the others have it. The point here was that we tried to do it and we always failed. It was very complicated to adjust it. So you take this part and turn it around and go down and you see some dropping down of the amplitudes, but it doesn't work. It really doesn't work. The reason was simply it works depending on your noise floor you have and your antenna, your combination you have. It works only in a certain small windows. If you came up in this functional windows, then it works. And in these windows, if you find this window with reducing of the amplitudes and the right to this one, then it works. But to find it without knowing the rest behind, you will never be successful. And this was the reason for the auto button. To bring you in this window, not maybe to optimize it, but you bring it in the windows so that you still have 90% of the possibility you can reduce, but you still can do it manually a little bit. And if you came in these windows, then you see exactly how small some, how fast is the reaction in this window. This was the main point.
Erwin, I think you should add one thing here. Markus also automatically switches the amplifier and the attenuator on channel 2. So we are not just trying to optimize the phase and the amplitude by moving the window around. We also optimize the amplitude by switching the amplifier and the attenuator. And this is also done automatically by the software.
So we have stop here. But if you want to interesting, because some words, the small antenna you receive, the noise is important compared to the big antenna you have. The other one is, we have the possibility to switch actuators and preamps on it so that we bring the levels together, and then you find the right points. Otherwise, it will not really work. So we should stop, or can we take one more?
One more.
Very quick one. The auto function, is that a dynamic function which will, as you continue to receive, it will dynamically adjust?
No, you have to trigger it manually, because it will take, let's say, 15 till 20 seconds, I don't know it exactly out of my mind, to turn around the whole face angle from 0 to 360 degree. So if you are switching from one band to another, for example, the software is saving the optimized point it has found before, band by band, but it cannot run in the background. Let's say you're tuning up a few kilohertz on the band you are currently, and do it automatically in the background, because it can only do normal receiving or measuring all the settings at one time. Yeah, we can show it to you.
Okay, thank you very, very much.
Thanks, guys.